गुड मॉर्निंग एवरीवन। आई होप वट एवर वी डिस्कस टिल नाउ अबाउट नेवियर स्टोक्स इक्वेशंस, मोमेंटम इक्वेशन, दैट इज ऑल क्लियर। बाय द वे, कैन यू ऑल हियर मी? So we discussed Navier-Stokes equations, that is continuity and momentum equations. Just to recap a little bit, continuity equation, del dot u equal to zero, momentum equations, rho dou u by dou t plus u dot del u minus del p if it is a Newtonian fluid, the viscous term becomes mu del square u. If there is a body force, that is rho g. G is a vector here, depending on the direction of gravity or any other body force, you will write that vector. So this is a vector equation. So depending on the number of dimensions, you will have those many number of equations. In three dimensions, this is one equation and these are three equations. The total four equations and four unknowns. That is what we discussed. And we solved a problem also for Couette flow. The bottom plate is not moving and the top plate is moving. The bottom plate is at zero velocity, the top plate is moving in the x direction with capital U, and we derived the velocity profile for this, which came out to be linear. Okay. Now I will give an assignment here. What you have to do is repeat the same thing for a pipe, or let's not make it very complicated. First, what you do is take two parallel plates like this in two dimensions, and let's say there is a pressure gradient from dp by dx. We have already derived this, that the pressure gradient will be a constant value. So for pipe flows, for flow between anything, any two parallel plates, dp by dx will have to be a constant. Also, here what we have assumed is that flow is laminar, it is not turbulent. Turbulent flow intrinsically means that it has to be unsteady. So we are talking about steady states here. A turbulent flow is chaotic in nature, so it cannot be steady. So here we are talking about laminar flows. The fluid is flowing like this. Okay. If I have to draw the streamlines, they will look like this. We will discuss what a streamline is and all these things. But just to give you an idea of what the flow will look like, it will be straight lines. Okay, parallel to the walls of the channel. So let's say this is again our coordinate system. Horizontal direction is x, vertical is y, and we have already said that, I'm not sure if we already discussed this, but the velocity profile will look like this, which is parabolic. So first problem is that derive the velocity profile that means u vector as a function of x, y, there is no time, it is steady state, so as a function of x, y for a pressure driven flow, I'll write. Here our plates are not moving, the flow is driven by a pressure gradient. So those kinds of flows are known as pressure driven flow between two parallel plates. Okay. This is the first problem. The second problem is there is a pipe and the flow is again pressure driven flow. In this case, to make it two dimensional, so that you don't have to solve several equations here, more than two equations of momentum, what you do is take a cylindrical coordinate system R Z and assume that it is axisymmetric. So in the azimuthal direction, everything is symmetric. So whatever plane you choose at whatever angle, you will get the same profile. That is our assumption. It is symmetric about the Z axis. That is the assumption. And now you will have to write this vector equation that we have written here in its cylindrical form, cylindrical coordinates. That is available on the internet and in standard textbooks also. So you can find that. That is the assignment. So here also derive u as a function of r z. Again for a pressure driven flow. For a pressure driven flow inside a pipe. Okay. In simpler terms, this is also called a pipe flow. Okay, pressure driven pipe flow. So these are the two problems for your assignment one. Now moving on, okay. Now as we saw, solving these equations is not very easy. For very simple problems, it may be easy, like these problems. These are two-dimensional in nature. And there are a lot of assumptions here. The assumption of incompressibility. We saw that if del dot u is zero, this is a simplification of a more complex mass conservation equation, okay, which was dou rho by dou t plus u dot del rho equal to zero. Okay. This was the equation, or I think del dot rho e equals equal to zero. This term was not there. It was del dot rho e. So this is a more complicated equation, but we simplified it saying that density is constant, or it is incompressible in nature. So we can come to this equation, del dot u equal to zero. You don't have to solve for the density variations in time and space. So this is the incompressible assumption, that the fluid or the flow is incompressible. Also, the assumptions are that it is steady flow, or we are calculating the solution at the steady state. Then it is a laminar flow. It is not turbulent. It is not chaotic. Many high speed flows are turbulent flows, so we are not going to high speed flows. We will also see what distinguishes laminar from turbulent. How does a flow go to a turbulent state? We will discuss all that. But right now, these are the assumptions that we have taken. Also, we said that the flow is unidirectional. So using all these simplifications in the Navier-Stokes equations, we derived the solution. Okay, but if the problem is more complex, you may not always get a closed solution. You may have to use computational fluid dynamics, which is a way of solving these equations on a computer. Okay, but you don't get an analytical solution. There is another use of these equations. You can use these equations in combination with experiments, okay, and derive some useful results. That is known as dimensional analysis. Okay. So what you have is this equation. These set of equations. Now, let's say you have a very big ship. Let's say it is some 400 meter long ship, okay, or 100 meter long ship. And you know the water properties, air properties. It is going to be used for some transportation of some goods in sea. Okay. Draw it here. This is water, air, and this is the ship. There is some length. These dimensions are known. Now you want to design this ship, let's say. There, what are the different forces that will act on this ship? You will have a propeller, which will propel the ship so that it moves forward. Let's say it is moving in this direction with some velocity. There will be some resistance, some viscous force, and some pressure force from the water. So you will have a net force acting here. Let's call it FD. This is known as drag force. Let me write it here. This force drags the ship. So it is kind of a resistance. That's why this is known as a drag force. Similar principle applies in airplanes, cars, everything. So air applies a drag force on airplanes. That's why you need a continuous operation of a jet engine, or in this case, in the case of a ship, a propeller to drive this ship at a constant speed. If you stop the propeller, after some time, the ship will also stop. That is because a force is acting, which is pulling the ship back, which is the drag force. And this propeller is giving some thrust. So in this direction, you have a thrust. Let's call it FT. Okay, thrust. Also, there is mass of the ship pulling it downwards. The gravity is pulling it down. Mg. Also, so that the ship keeps afloat, there is a force upwards, FB, let's call it, which is buoyancy. Okay. And because of the waves may not be always symmetric in this direction of motion. So there can be sideways forces also, which can rock the ship. Okay. Wind forces can be there. All such forces can be there. But these are the main forces that act on a ship. So now you want to design this ship to carry a certain load. Let's say you are designing this ship for some mass MD, which is the design. You are designing the ship for this M design mass, so that the ship can carry this much mass above it. Now you have to design the geometry of the ship, the propeller, and all the components of this ship. You want to estimate the drag force that it will experience, the buoyancy force that it will experience, the thrust that the propeller will generate. All of these things you want to estimate, and the final velocity that it will attain. So that is also a design requirement, that the ship should move at a particular velocity. Now, if you had to do only the experiments to estimate all these things, it will be a very difficult task, because you will have to make this big a ship. And if that doesn't fulfill your requirements, then you have to build the ship again, which is that big. So it will cost a lot. So what people do is they design smaller ships and use dimensional analysis to estimate the forces, the velocity, everything, the thrust on this bigger ship using the equations that we already know. Okay. So what they do is, let's say this is L actual or L design, and U design, thrust design, all of them you can associate with this design subscript. Now what we make is a model ship which looks similar. So this is known as geometrical similarity. So if it looks similar, you call it geometrical similarity. So you are saying that it is similar to the actual ship, the design ship, but all the dimensions have been reduced by a certain factor. So let us call this L model. This is your model ship. And there is certain ratio between L model and L design. So similarly, all the dimensions, all of these dimensions will be scaled. So there is some scaling factor here. So these two are geometrically similar. But now what you want is, you want to conduct some tests on it, and you want to find out the force that this ship will experience, and then you will translate that force to the design force. Okay. So let's say you put this ship in water, and there is some mass also here for this ship. How much should that mass be so that you get that much buoyancy force and only that much level is inside the water? How much of the ship is submerged inside the water? That should also be the same. Okay. By same, I mean scaled by that much factor, L model by L design. All of these things you have to take care of. Now there is another concept called dynamical similarity. और डायनामिक सिमिलैरिटी व्हाट दिस मीन्स इज दैट यू हैव टू टेक द वेलोसिटी ऑफ दिस शिप द प्रोपेलर थ्रस्ट द मास ऑल ऑफ दीज थिंग्स सच दैट यू कैन स्केल ऑल द फोर्सेज ऑल्सो बाय अ सर्टेन नंबर. It should not be that the thrust force that you have, let's say you take the same velocity here and here, then certainly the force that you are going to get here will be different from the actual drag force, because that ship is very big, this ship is very small. Okay. The buoyancy force may be different, the thrust force will be different. So if I say FD design by FD model, if this is not equal to FE design and FP model, that is the thrust force ratio and the drag force ratio and any other force ratio, if these ratios are not same, then the models are not dynamically similar. Then you have chosen some wrong velocity for the ship, some wrong propeller speed for the ship. Okay, which is why these two are not similar. So how to guarantee dynamic similarity? That is what comes from these equations, the Navier-Stokes equations. So you can use those equations such that these two model and the actual ship are dynamically similar. So let us see how we do that. So let me write the equations for the actual ship here and the equations for the model ship on the right. Del dot u equal to 0. Okay. This is the momentum equation. Equations of course will be same, but the numbers that will appear there will be different. Okay. Now what are the differences? Let us try to understand. Let us consider the continuity equation first. The velocities that are there, we are talking about their gradients. So if I expand this equation, continuity equation, it will be dou u by dou x and dou v by dou y equal to 0. Now the gradient of u with respect to x, that is the derivative of u with respect to x. Of course, that will be different from the derivative of u with respect to x here. Okay, if we don't pay attention to it. Let's say the velocity is capital U in a big ship here. And the velocity after this L design length, that is something else, let's say very low. Okay. Let's say u by 10 or something. Then the gradient of velocity dou u by dou x will be u minus u by 10 divided by L design. Okay, I'm talking about a very crude, the derivative in a very crude sense. This is at a point, but I'm talking about a big length here. Okay, assuming that it is linear. That is the slope of u with respect to x. But if you have the same thing here, the length is very small. You can see it is just L model. So it can be very different. Also here, if we take velocity in, let's say, kilometer per hour, and in our model, let's say the velocity is some meter per hour, okay, because it is a small system. Then also, because the units are different, so these two derivatives can be different if we don't pay attention to it. So what we need to do is, we need to make this dou u by dou x same as this dou u by dou x here. Okay. So how do we do that? That is the part of dimensional analysis. Also, one more thing. In momentum equation, we have to make the pressure gradient same. So the pressure change with respect to the x or y, that should be same in the model and the actual ship. Similarly, the second derivatives of the velocity, those also should be same if viscosities are same. Also, all of these things, the change in velocity with respect to time, that should also be the same at every point in space. Okay, so you get the idea. Now we'll talk about non-dimensionalization, which helps in solving this problem. How to make these quantities same in the model and the actual shape. Okay. So this is our goal. This is, I think it is clear. Now to do this, we are talking about non-dimensionalization. So what we want to do is, instead of writing these numbers, velocity, pressure, time, in terms of their units, because these numbers have some units, what we will do is, we will convert them to non-dimensional numbers. How do we do that? Let's say the x dimension, that is in meters generally, in SI units, right? So if I have to write its dimension, it is m0 l1 t0, or simply length units. So this x we can write as some x star, which is a dimensionless number. It doesn't have any dimension associated with it, times some length. So let us call it LD or L design. So L design has units of length, and x has units of length. So x star is a non-dimensional number, or a dimensionless number. Is this part clear? Is there any question? Okay, so we'll move on. So what we are saying here is, now onwards we will measure x in terms of LD. So how many LDs can we fit in a certain length x? In other words, instead of using a meter as our reference scale, we are using LD as our reference scale. Okay. So instead of asking, for example, what is the length of your phone, let's say, in meters. What I am asking is, what is the length of your phone in terms of LD? How many LDs? So you will say 1/10 of an LD, or 1/50 of LD of the ship length. So we have converted our unit to LD, simply speaking. So this number will be dimensionless now. It doesn't have a dimension of meter, centimeter, anything. Now the unit is only associated with this LD. Similarly, for velocities. So similarly for y also, we can write y star and some length scale. So in this case, let us assume that in x and y, both the directions, we are using the same length scale, LD. Similarly, for velocity in x direction, u star is the dimensionless velocity. And let us take the ship speed, capital U, capital UD again, let's call it. That is the design speed of the actual ship. Similarly, for the vertical velocity, that is in the other direction, y direction, v star ud. Similarly, if in the third dimension you want it, that is the vertical direction, in the direction of gravity, you can take a w and w star ud. But right now, let us do it for two dimensions. Similarly, what about time? For time also, you can take some time scale. But because we already have a length scale and a velocity scale, we can make a time scale out of these two. So we'll call it the dimensionless time will be t star. And we have LD by UD as our time scale. That has the units of time. Similarly, for other variables such as pressure, we'll say P star times some scale for pressure, which has units of pressure. Now, can you make a combination of these scales and the known numbers such as density, viscosity of the water? Can you combine these rho, mu, LD, UD in such a way that it forms the unit of pressure? So take 2 minutes and please let me know. You can write in the chat window. Any of you got any answers? Okay. That's one answer. The unit of viscosity is Pascal second. And if you divide that by second, then you get Pascal, which is unit of pressure. Yes, that is correct. That can be one way of writing this. So that will be mu u by L, mu u d by L d. Okay. So that is one way of doing it. There can be several ways of doing it. Another way of doing it is rho ud square. Okay. If you see, if you check, this also has units of pressure. So let's try to write this. This is kg per meter cube. And then ud is meter per second square. So kg per meter second square. And what is Pascal? That is force per unit area. Force is mass times acceleration. That is kg, mass times acceleration, meter per second square, and per unit area, meter square. So that also gives you kg per meter second square. So both ways you can write it. That changes what equation you get finally, but there is not very big difference in it. So let us just use this mu ud by ld. Okay. In your free time, you can also use rho ud square and see what difference it makes in the equation. Okay, so now I think we have all our terms here. X, Y, U, T, P. Is there anything else that is remaining here? Rho and mu, we are going to write them as it is there. Okay. Now let us start with the continuity equation. Del dot U equal to zero. If we expand it, dou u by dou x plus dou v by dou y equal to 0. Now, how do you write dou u by dou x in terms of these starred quantities, the dimensionless numbers? So, an easy way is to just replace u by the corresponding expression, u star into ud. Let us write that dou u star ud by dou. X also we can write x star into LD. We have written that already. Plus V star UD by Y star LD equal to zero. Now we know that UD and LD are fixed. They are not changing with space or time. They are the ship speed and the length of the ship, which are fixed quantities. They can be taken out of the derivative sign. So from the first term, you get ud by ld. From the second term also ud by ld. They get cancelled, okay, because on the right hand side it is zero. So you can take them to the right hand side, ud by ld. Finally, the equation that you get is dou u star by dou x star plus dou v star by dou y star equal to zero, which is the same as the original continuity equation. So what this implies is that let's say you have your velocities as 10 meter per second is u, let's say 5 meter per second is v, and it is changing, of course, So let's say u is changing from 10 to 15 in some region, and v is changing from 5 to 0, let's say, in some region, over certain x and y in meters again. So the derivative that you will get, what will be dou u by dou x in terms of its units? So it will be meter per second by meter, that is 1 by second. So let's say in dimensional units, it is 1 by second, the first term. And it is, let's say, 0.1. 0.1, 1 by second, or second inverse, that is the unit. Now, if it is 0.1 per second or 0.1 per hour or 0.1 per day, it does not change the continuity equation, because we just saw that now this is dimensionless number, right? U star, V star, X star, Y star. So only the number matters here. It is 0.1, let's say. The unit does not matter here. It doesn't have any unit. It is just a number here. So if you say that U star is 0.1, X star is 1, or dou U star by dou X star is 0.1, you are not specifying any units here. It is dimensionless number. So it is valid, equally valid for any unit. Units don't play a role here. It can be any unit and it will be valid. Okay, is that clear?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now let us go to the momentum equation. Let's write the momentum equation. Rho, dou u by dou t plus u dot del u. I will expand that. U dou u by dou x plus v dou u by dou y. I'm writing in two dimensions only, not writing the third term for the third dimension, but it will be similar. Minus dou p by dou x, and let me do it only for one direction, that is x direction, plus mu dou 2 u by dou x square dou y square. And let us not include any gravity term here. Now this is rho. The second term, u star ud. For time we wrote t star ld by ud. You can check that again. Second term, u star ud. U star UD, X star LD. This X is written as X star LD. Similarly, the third term, V star UD. U star UD, Y star LD. Okay. This is the left hand side. The right hand side, what did we write for pressure? Mu ud by ld. P star mu ud by ld by x star ld. Okay. Mu dou 2 u star ud by dou x square, that is x star ld square, dou 2 u star u d by y star l d square. Okay, this is the right hand side. Now let us take these fixed quantities out of the derivative symbols. The first term, this time term, what do we get from there? U d square by L d. Let us write that rho U d square by L d. Now pay attention to this also, this point, that every term which is added that is dimensionally consistent. So the dimension of every term which is added has to be the same for the entire equation to be dimensionally consistent, right? You cannot add a kg to a meter. Both the terms should have the same dimension. So the first term, whatever dimension it has, we wrote u d square by l d here, that's what came out from the brackets. Second term should also have that outside its derivatives, right? Because inside whatever we are writing is dimensionless. So whatever will remain is dou u star by dou x star, right, from here. And here also you will have u star. All of these are dimensionless numbers. They don't have any dimension. So whatever comes out from these brackets, that is, that should be same as any other term which is added to it. So we got u d square by l d from the time term, the time derivative. And that is what we will get from the next term also. So dou u star by dou t star plus, again, u d square by l d came out common, so we took it out with rho. Now we have u star dou u star by dou x star plus v star dou u star by dou y star. This is the left hand side, and the right hand side. Now what is common from the pressure term? It is minus mu u d by l d square. Dou x star plus, again you see that it is the same term, l d square, sorry, not star, just l d, dou 2 u star by dou x star square, dou 2 u star dou y star square. Okay, but we see that on the left hand side and on the right hand side the terms are slightly different, but of course their dimensions must be same. That you can confirm, but that is the case actually. So let us take this rho u d square by l d to the right hand side and see what we get. So on the left hand side you get the same term from the Navier-Stokes that we had, dou u star by dou t star plus u star dou u star by dou x star plus v star dou u star by dou y star equal to, now, mu u d by l d square into l d by u d square, and there is a rho, so one l d goes away, one u d goes away, And what you get is rho x star plus rho x star square rho y star square. Now you don't have any dimensional number anywhere except this combination of dimensional numbers. And what this is? This is mu by rho ud ld. This is multiplied here. What this equation says is that if you have velocity, pressure, both the velocities and pressure, some numbers independent of their units. It can be centimeter per second velocity, it can be meter per second, it can be meter per hour, meter per day, doesn't matter. If you have a number for velocity, that will satisfy this equation. Okay, whatever units you want to choose, that depends on you. But if you have a number, it will satisfy this equation, independent of its unit. Given that this number should be the same for that meter per second equation and for that kilometer per day equation. If this number is same, then both the equations give the same result in the dimensionless form. Okay. So let's say for the model, you have a dimensionless velocity of 0.1, and for the actual ship also you have a dimensionless velocity which is same 0.1. That can be in kilometer per hour and this can be in meter per second. Okay, the units can be different, the numbers should match. Then if the corresponding number which is multiplied here, if this is same for the model and the ship, then this momentum equation will have the same result. Okay, then both the equations are actually same for the model and the ship because the numbers are same. So what we want for dynamical similarity or dynamic similarity is that this number for the actual ship and for the model ship should be same. U model, let's say L model, this number should be same. Of course we have missed a few things here, we will talk about that later on. If these numbers are same, if you select your U model, L model, rho, mu for the model such that it is same as mu by rho ud ld, then it is guaranteed that for both model and the ship, the forces, the momentum, basically momentum balance, that will satisfy the same equation. Is this equation we have written. Okay. So we'll talk about how to find out the force for the actual ship if we know the force for the model ship from this information here. So we'll do that in the next class. If there is any question, you can ask right now.
So what is the date to submit the assignment?
Okay. Okay, let's take a week's time. So what is the date? Let's see. 6th, right, 6th September, let's say just after that, 7th September. This is the deadline for submission.
Okay, sir. Sir, would you please upload the last class recording on YouTube?
Yeah, sure.
So that would, yeah. Thank you.
Yeah. Okay, thank you. there is no other question, we'll end here.